Hi everyone, thanks so much for watching my YouTube tutorial today. We will paint a black cat, which is walking, and I used a photo which is just a silhouette of a black cat walking. So copy or print screen it if you wanna paint this cat with me. As you can see, it's pretty simple. We mainly playing with the watercolor effects, and you need to get the silhouette right, but we don't have other complicated thing in it like face or difficult structure, so I assume this will be not too hard. It is a wet on wet tutorial, and it lasts about, let's say, an hour, I guess, is enough to make this painting, because you don't need to wait for masking fluid and stuff. So it's just one sitting from start to end. And I will introduce in details the tools and the materials you need. That's also very simple in this case. You don't need too much thing. So if you feel you want to paint something like this with me, prepare the tools and the materials, and I promise it's not too hard. It's not extremely easy either, but it's not too hard. So see you in the next section where I show the tools and the materials. So I painted this cat on a artist quality watercolor paper, which was a Langton Prestige. It was a large full size sheet, 22 by 30 inches, called press. But I show here several other watercolor paper type I like to use, and I think any good quality watercolor paper will be fine. So if you don't have the Langton Prestige, I would suggest Arch or Arches, and probably anything else would work. Especially Kilimanjaro is a good choice because it's not too pricey. So beside the paper, you will need few large water bowl, at least two, but you need a lot of water and water changes. Use big bowl, white or transparent, and don't use the water when it's too dirty. So this is why I'm saying more than two is better, because you can prepare several next to you. It's very important to always have one completely clean around you if you need to wash off something suddenly. I will do that, so you can see how I do it when I'm unhappy with a bigger area, but this always require a completely clean full bowl of water. After that, you will need brushes. I would say one mottler to wet the paper, and even during painting I use it a few times. The mottlers are on the top. These are no-name mottlers. I bought it in an art store in the Chinese section. It was really cheap, and I'm quite happy with them, so don't need to buy a quality mottler, I mean, unless you want it. But quality mottler can be really expensive because they are large. You need a watercolor pencil to draw some outline, just some, any kind, any brand is fine, just watercolor pencil, something gray, brown, something dark blue like this would be fine. I think the brands are all fine. You will need few brushes. I like the Princeton Aqualite or the Princeton Neptune. And I have larger rounds and smaller rounds. That I also like the oval wash. So just several different brushes. The larger brush is probably more important in this case. If you buy round, it's between 16 to 20, what I call large. If you get the quill, which has the metal above the brush part, that's called quill. From quill, it's size 6 or 8. I think it's enough large, and I have few smaller, like 8 or so, for details. So I use a spray bottle just for wetting my paper. Also, you need wipe. You can see my favorite Kim wipes, but if you don't have that, just use a kitchen paper towel. It's not the same, but working quite well. And Kim wipe is pricey and hard to get. Please don't use toilet paper or tissue paper. It will fall apart from your wet watercolor paper, and it's extremely frustrating. Regarding paint, I use tube Horadam or Daniel Smith. For black, I always use the lamp black color, no matter which brand coming from. But usually, I use these two brands you can see on the image. Other than that, I use some colors, some kind of blue, some kind of orangey brown, and maybe even other colors, but honestly, if you have a watercolor set, I would use the colors from there and maybe would buy the lamp black. If you don't have a proper good black, it's kind of important to use lamp black because how this paint is behave and it don't have too much drying shift. So when I prepare my tube paint, I use these ceramic dishes and I just put out the paint into them and I dilute it up a little bit to a heavy cream consistency before starting to paint. And this is what I suggest to you, unless you use half pans, it will be more difficult because the half pans are tiny. And in my case, at least, it's a large painting about real size. So the cat is real cat size. I think it's harder to work smaller, but you can go down smaller to like 18 by 24 inches or so. But I wouldn't go smaller than that. It's just not as fun to paint. So I also use this plastic palette or whatever it's called to if I need to mix, but I usually just mix on a paper while I am painting, and you can also see the color. So I have some kind of blue, some kind of reddish orange and browny orange, and of course the black is the main color. And if you have all this, we can start to draw. So I'm using my watercolor pencil and I try to sketch out the cat on my quite large paper. This is a watercolor pencil, so while you wet your paper, it mostly will disappear, but try to make it enough strong or when you wet your paper, just be careful not to eliminate all the lines. But don't push your pencil on the paper because you will hurt the surface and it will stain by the watercolor like much more than the not hurt part of the paper. And you will see those lines in darker color if you just push it too hard and you damage the structure of the paper surface. So you need a good balance to not push it too hard, but also if it's too light, it will immediately disappear when you wet the paper. And since it's wet on wet technique, after we have the drawing, I will wet the whole paper surface. So try to be careful with the placement. It's better if a cat have a little bit more space front of the nose than behind the tail. Just it's like the psychological effect. So it has a space to go because it's walking. So you don't want the face touching or be very close to the edge of the paper because it will generate a feeling that the cat is blocked in his walking. So it's just better that way. So as I said, it's all about silhouette. This is why the painting is kind of on the easy side. So you only need to concentrate on the silhouette. And after that, probably playing with the colors and the effect, how the watercolor behave on wet paper. So that will give probably the beauty part of the painting. Another thing is important beside the placement is the ratios within the cat body. So that's good to get it right, like not to have a too big head or too small head and stuff like that. But yeah, just try to get that silhouette approximately right. Of course, during painting, you can adjust the edges at least in the positive direction, so you can always make it bigger. But it's usually hard if you have to modify it during painting, so it's better to get the drawing, the outline part, correct. Of course, I don't want to cut off the tail, so I was thinking which direction to curve the tail, but I ending up with going downwards. If you have more space on the top, it can stay upwards, but I left more space below the cat because I want to add the shadow. I think for this cat, how it's working, I think the shadow is really a nice addition, but you can choose other way around too, so you can leave more space on the top and work on the tail, or leave more space for the tail. If you are done with the drawing part, make sure you prepare your water bowls. You dilute up your paint, or if you use pens, you wet them up, so everything ready to go. And yeah, put everything around you, make sure it's ready to use before you start to wet your paper with a spray bottle and your mottler. You can go alone with the mottler too. If you don't have spray bottle, you can wet your paper with a big brush too, so it's fine. Just don't start to wet your paper before you're completely ready to paint, because this wet-on-wet painting is always a fight with the time, because you don't want your paper dry fast, because then everything behaves very different. So just try to work in that phase when your paper is wet. So I'm done with the drawing, and if you are too, then we can start to wet the paper. So as you can see, I'm using the spray bottle, spray it everywhere, and then when it's sprayed everywhere, I use the mottler brush to equalize the wetness. I want my paper pretty wet, but not dripping. I don't want puddles, but it's really wet. So, and also, you need a little time until this wetness sinks into the structure of the paper. So I just use more water from the bowl and make sure it's equally wet everywhere, without dripping. And I do this for a few minutes, but try to not eliminate your drawing. So make sure you can sit a little bit still. and just wait a minute or two and then you can start to paint. Starting to paint, you will need a pre-diluted heavy cream consistency lamp black. At least this is how I do. Sometimes I start with the lighter colors, but this time I started with the black, probably because it's a silhouette more than anything else. So you can see my paint is pretty dense, not as dense as the tube, of course. And I'm using a big brush and putting down large areas with the black. Since I'm showing everything what I'm doing, so you can see my every brush stroke, I won't talk all the way, just when I feel it's necessary. And so just put behind your favorite music or whatever you like to paint on. And when something important happening, I will tell. So you can see I'm adding the colors. And I'm starting to work first on the bigger surfaces because it's flowy. So you can't do details in the beginning because it's flowing. But you can add the colors and they do beautiful things when they meet. They flow into each other and generating beautiful effects. So start with the larger areas and put down the main idea of it, a big brush. And then later we're going into the direction of the details. Try to think about more colors at that point and maybe a little bit about body shape or shading on the body, but the details like ear or, I don't know, paws, stuff like that come later when it's not flowing that much. Also, you can see I got a third color, which is transparent orange, probably from Horadam. Also, you can put down the shadow because it's also a big kind of homogeneous color block. Especially if you do a large one like me, you can start to put down now already. For the legs, I only label them so far. I think I will need vibe them also because they're flowing too much, so they became thick. So this is why I'm saying that it can come later, and I'm just labeling where the ear will be, but it's flowing, so you can't leave it as it is. So I just try to dry the area to stop the flowing, but it's just better to work on those parts later when it starts to dry. You can see I'm thinning the leg because it's too flowy again. So as I suggested, try to work on the bigger block of things where you don't mind if it's flowing too much. If you need to change things with wiping, change it early as possible. As it's drying, it will be harder and harder to change, but when it's still pretty wet, it's easy to change. So either you can wipe it off with a clean paper towel, or you need to clean your brush with a completely clean water bowl loosen up the painting you want to remove with a clean brush, clean water, and then wipe it off. If it starts to dry, that's the method. The drier the paint, it's harder to remove, and eventually it's impossible. You can probably lighten, but not remove it. But if you remove it in the beginning, right away, when it's still wet, then you do something wrong, and you recognize it early, that's usually not too hard. It's usually, even a black usually come off pretty well. But it's a short period of time, the window close soon. As soon as it starts to settle into the paper, it's not possible anymore. You can see I have issue with flowing too much, so the legs not staying as I intended, so I have to wipe. And again, if you are able to wait, wait with the legs a little bit, for a little bit later, when it's a little bit drier. But as you can see, I have no issue to remove paint with a clean paper towel. The paper towel, you always need to turn around and use a clean surface of it. If your paper towel is dirty, it can make a quite terrible mess. So just make sure you turn around and use always a clean spot on it. I like to keep sharper edges on surfaces where the fur is shorter, like legs, and fluffier, furrier edge of the paint on places like back or tail or the thigh area or the belly where the cat is normally fluffier. So just use this contrast, the sharp edge and the soft edge of the cat to express how fluffy the fur there. So I was quite unhappy with the head shape, so I remove it a little bit. So you will see, this is why you need the clean bowl. You can use your mottler to remove stuff like on a large scale if you want to do that. And then you need a clean towel. As you can see, some places where I like painting now, it's where I paint now, it's dry enough to not flowing too far any longer. So I try to thinning a little bit and washing back a little bit on the back side of the cat where it's receive more light. You can see even from the shape and the direction of the shadow that the light coming from behind the from the direction of the back. There is no exact solution how to work with the colors here. I suggest you to be brave and bold and use the colors and wash them back. And also I suggest to use the effect, what you can clearly see on my painting right now, where the painting is semi-dry, so not dry, but it's not shiny anymore. So the paint is pretty settled and matte, but if you would touch, you can stain your hand. And when you add water at that point to paint, it starts to bloom or generate blooms, or other words called cauliflowers, and that's a beautiful effect, what is very unique to watercolor. And I always use them for the wet on wet technique. I really love them, so I suggest you to look up this effect. I have videos about too. It's called the two watercolor technique I often use, or something like that. If you don't know what is it, but you can see it's look like little like it's generate flurry fluffy structures on the edge of the water. So when you have a surface with a semi-dry paint and you add water, you can see it's pushing the paint forward, and that's generate where the edge of the water is generate these blooms or cauliflowers. And they are quite beautiful and very unique to watercolor. And currently you can see it on some places on my painting, especially around the tail and the back area. As you can see on the back of my cat, that's the danger of adding the water. You can have an overspread with the blooms, but I'm correcting it right now with my big mottler. And I'm trying to generate those blooms downwards, not going upwards. You can see clearly what kind of edge this waterfront generates in a paint. I want to have similar on the belly, so I added their water with my big mottler too. So that's what I said in the beginning, or that's what I refer to. It's more like playing with the effect of the watercolor and the colors, because regarding the cat, it's a silhouette, so there you have much less to play with. So it's more about the technique and the behavior of the watercolor paint and the wet-on-wet technique. So now many places are quite dry, so you can add details with thinner brush on a face or on the paw area or wherever fine details are visible. So you can work there with less risk to overflowing. Also, I'm quite close to finish, so I don't want to like overdo it or or stuff, which is very common with watercolor. So I kind of know that I'm finishing up soon. So usually that point I look for the last touches I want to make, or areas which I don't like that much and I want to retouch. What is important, the first 10-20 minutes of the drying process, it's better to keep your eye on it, because some places can just start to do weird overflowing and stuff which you didn't expect. So it's good to watch, and if you need to interfere with things happening on your paper, you do it. But it's not that common, but it's just better to keep in mind. Also, when you put down your paper to dry somewhere, make sure that thing don't have pattern. Like, for example, my tiles is not a good place, because the wet watercolor paper will pick up and dry on based on the pattern below. So if you wanna dry it, please put either on a very smooth surface or put under some other paper, thicker paper sheet, if you don't want that effect, and just let it naturally dry. It take several hours, probably even overnight, if it's enough wet like mine. So make sure it's drying in peace without picking up a pattern. And finally, I would like just say thank you for watching my YouTube video. If you want to help me, please watch my videos all the way. And if you want to learn from me more, go to Skillshare. Please use my referral link. It's placed below. You can use Skillshare for some time free, probably a week or two, and buy original from Etsy or Saatchi art. Thank you so much, and see you next time. Bye.